Speaking of the gospel, we heard a tremendous, simple message about the gospel last night, how to share it. We're going to be singing about that, 538, simply saying, I love to tell the story. And is that your testimony as a believer, wanting to share the gospel, tell others about that good news of salvation? 538, let's stand together as we sing 538.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story,
is going to sing a new tune to an old hymn, Be Thou Exalted. We have so many reasons to worship and to praise our dear Savior. Think about them, meditate on some of those reasons as the choir sings. Worship along with the choir as we exalt our Savior.
Be thou exalted forever.
371. Is this your prayer, that you have a passion for our Savior? The writer says, set my heart, O thee, Father, on thee and thee only. 371, as we make this our prayer this evening.
Set my heart, O dear Father, on thee and thee only. Give me a thirst for thy presence divine. Lord, keep my focus on loving thee wholly. Purge me from earth, turn my heart after thine. A passion for thee
One final time this evening, 512 in your hymn book, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Is this your testimony? Do people around you know that you're redeemed? Let's stand together. 512, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus, no language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer, I think of Him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and
singing. You may be seated. Pastor and Dave Kermott will bring special music.
In Isaiah 44, God is promising millennial blessings to the nation of Israel, and He describes it this way. Yet now hear, O Jacob, my servant, and Israel, whom I have chosen. Thus saith the Lord that hath made thee and formed thee from the womb, which will help thee. Fear not, O Jacob, my servant, and thou Jeshurun, whom I have chosen. And here's the verse, and this is the words that we're going to be singing tonight. For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thine offspring. And we have, in New Testament days, we've often taken that verse, because it speaks of the Spirit of the Lord, and we compare it to the floods on the dry ground, and we ask the Lord for an outpouring of His Spirit. What Brother Barber already preached on, being filled with the Spirit, is the biblical concept for us. We want God's Spirit to have free reign. Totally control us. There we go. But have the ability to take the Word of God and speak to our hearts. And that's a wonderful, picturesque way for us to say, Lord, I'm thirsty tonight. I want to hear from you, I want to understand your word, and I want to grow in you. So it's proper for us, I think, in that sense, to pray, Lord, pour out thy spirit on this thirsty soul tonight.
Come, everyone who is thirsty in spirit. Come, everyone who is weary and sad. Come to the fountain, there's fullness in Jesus. All that you're longing for, come and be glad. I will pour water on him who is thirsty.
wonderful testimony and song. And great to see you here tonight as you continue to cast your vote for revival in this church. Good to have you here tonight, and a few more votes tonight. Praise the Lord. All the kids are heading out. They're excited to go. It's good to see happy feet running to go hear the children's lesson. And they're continuing to hear the adventures of Hudson Taylor, a great missionary to China. And we're excited about what God has been doing in our meeting this week. And, of course, I can't see and you can't see what's going on in hearts, but I believe God is working in hearts, and I just trust that the Lord is going to do something special in our hearts even tonight. You have a handout, and it's bare bones, and it's got no blanks, because I'll forget to give you the blanks anyway. So it's got spaces between the lines where you can jot things down if you wish. It's really just an opportunity for you to have something to take home and meditate on what we look at tonight. Sometimes we have to kind of go faster than I want to go as we go through this material, but I hope that tonight will be a blessing. Go ahead and turn in your Bibles to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4. As you're turning there, I'm going to explain the title of this outline, this message tonight. The title is To Love and Be Loved. And we've got an acronym, L-O-V-E-D. We're going to look at what love is tonight. But that phrase, to love and be loved, actually I heard that phrase in a strange way. Perhaps you're familiar with Nat King Cole, maybe Christmas time. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Those kind of old classic tunes. And when I think of Christmas, I think of some of those sounds. And well, he's actually known for another song. Don't go Google it now or whatever, but another song. It's not a Christian song at all. It's a secular song, but it's a very unique, almost mysterious, melodic melody. And it's entitled Nature Boy. It's kind of strange, and it's sort of this mystic parable about this ageless child who has lived and seen the rise and fall of kings and kingdoms, and he's full of wisdom. And there's a conversation between this being, whatever he is, and as they go through the song, the final statement really kind of is interesting. It says this: the greatest thing you can ever learn is to be loved and to love in return. Now, that's a strange thought. The greatest thing that can be learned is to love and to love in return. And, of course, that's just a secular tune, a forgotten melody, but it's an eternal theme from age to age, culture to culture. Folks who've never heard about Jesus, guess what they're looking for? Guess what they're seeking for? They're looking for love. They really are. There's a deep longing to love and to be loved in return. Many a story, romantic novel or whatever, has been written about this theme of love and often unrequited love. Some of the greatest heartache comes when you pour your love out, but someone sets it aside, or they don't reciprocate the love that you have for them. Great heartache, many tears, many broken hearts about this subject of love. We want to have this back and forth of to love and to be loved. It's God-given. And you don't need to consult an ageless child to get that kind of wisdom. It's in the Bible, all right? We're made in the image of God, and we were made for a love relationship with God. And so it's no wonder that since sin came into the world and we've been separated from God, that primary love relationship has been ruined. And so you have people of all ages, all cultures, searching for this connection of love being given and received. And sadly, by the millions and millions and millions, they're coming up empty. And going from relationship to relationship to relationship, searching for this kind of thing that they can only really find in God. And only can find in their spouse according to biblical principles as God works through them. And Many times in a group like this, we have no idea the kind of heartache and the kind of scars that are here among us because of love or the lack of it. The misunderstandings about love. And not only that, but it's possible to love and not have it received. It's also possible to be loved and not know it. I've heard husbands come to me and just bewail the fact that no matter what they do, their wife feels unloved. I tell her, I show her, I don't know what to do. I don't know what, she thinks I don't love her, but I die for her. And sure enough, I interview the wife. My husband doesn't love me. We have no relationship. Oh yeah, he does this and does that, but you don't understand. He doesn't love me. Something's not happening there, right? She feels unloved. And yet he feels as though he would cut off his right arm to help her. And he's trying to love her, but somehow he's missing the mark. And she's not catching the signals. And I know some of you are already thinking, okay, five love languages. You know, he's got to get on her wavelength. And hey, if you're familiar with that book, nothing wrong with it per se. There's some wisdom in that. I'll just get ahead of myself a little bit and say, it's not always as easy as speaking someone's love language. It's possible to speak the perfect language and still the person who's being loved actually doesn't know how to be loved. Did you know it's possible to not know how to receive love? And we should understand this because it just so happens that God Almighty is pouring out his love to this world through Jesus Christ. Is his love received? Does it even register on most hearts? And yet he poured out love in the most perfect way. It's possible to love and not have it received. It's possible to be loved and not know it. And we're going to ask the Lord to help us tonight, not only to know how to love, but also how to receive the love that's being given to us. This will help your marriage. This will help your parenting. This will help your friendships. And you know, as the songs say, love makes the world go round. I don't know, but you know what? Jesus makes the world go round, and my Bible says that God is love. They're almost right. But see, this world doesn't know much about real Bible love. They don't know what they're talking about when they say L-O-V-E. They're not sure what that really means. They're not sure what they're looking for. Well, if you're saved, you know what they're looking for. His name is Jesus. All right, let's go to 1 John chapter 4. There's a lot about love in 1 John. In fact, we could read the first verse of chapter 3. Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed on us, that we should be called the sons of God. Last night we looked at that, the simple gospel, how to be born again. Isn't that the greatest display of love of all? That we should be called the sons of God. But here, let's zero in on verse 7 of chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. He that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Jump down to verse 11. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. And then a couple verses, we're going to grab some highlights. Look at verse 16. And we have known and, what's the next word? Say it out loud. Believed. Let's try it again. And we have known and believed the love that God hath toward us. God is love. He that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God. Jump down to verse 19. Let's say it out loud together. Ready? We love him. Because he first loved us. I'm summarizing this passage with this simple phrase, the overflow principle. Because if we're going to love and be loved, we have to find out where love comes from, and we have to be plugged into that source so that we then can love others from the overflow. And we're going to explain this foundational principle, and then we're going to jump into our acronym in the remaining time. But let's pause right now and ask the Lord to help us. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that we can be here tonight. Lord, I cannot take your truth into someone's heart, but you can. Spirit of God, we're asking you to do that tonight. There may be some here tonight that do not, in their heart of hearts, they don't feel loved. They don't feel loved of God. They don't feel loved by those that they wish to feel loved by. There's a sadness, there's a darkness, there's a hopelessness. There's anger and bitterness that love could solve if love could touch that wound. And Lord, I pray that even tonight, your love would touch that heart. That you would help us to know and believe the love that you have toward us. That you'd teach us to love others from the overflow. Teach us what it means to actually love someone. Teach us to recognize when someone is showing love to us. Teach us to open our hearts to receive that. And Lord, ultimately, I pray that you would destroy the work of Satan, who's trying to keep us bound in unbelief and hardness and bitterness and darkness and despair. Lord, overthrow that. Let your love pour out in every heart for your glory. And help me, Lord, as I preach. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You know, I am afraid that there are many, many children that know mom and dad love them. If you were to ask them privately or one-on-one, do your parents love you? I think many kids, especially among Christian households, many kids would say, yeah, mommy loves me. But I just my own interaction with children and with families, and this is not a broad brush, but I really believe that if they were honest, if they had the boldness to be honest, you might hear something like this. Well, daddy loves me, but I'm not sure he likes me. I don't think he likes me very much. Well, I know mommy loves me, but I don't think I'm her favorite. I don't think she likes me as much as she likes someone else, my brother, my sister. Well, I know mommy loves me. I know dad loves me, but I don't think he really cares about me that much. I don't think he really likes me. And yet, if you were to interview their parents, do you love your children? Yes! How much do you love them? I'd do anything for my child. I'd die for my kids. I'd do anything in the world. I love them with my whole heart. Okay, I'm sure you do. But little Johnny, he doesn't think you like him very much. Now, Johnny might not be very easy to like. But are any of us perfect little angels? We're all sinners, aren't we? And it's very possible for someone to not feel loved, even though the one doing the loving really believes that they love them. It's possible for a wife to not feel loved, even though the husband says and believes that he loves her. There can be a real disconnect and a lot of heartache and a lot of wounds, because the one who wishes they felt that, they don't feel it, and pretty soon they go off into the wide, wide world to search for it, don't they? And they go for relationships, they go for experiences, they go for a community where they can find that vibe, that something that they're looking for. They find destructive habits, all kinds of things, in really just the simple pursuit of the connection that they can't seem to find among the ones they love. We need to know how to love. If anybody should, it's a Christian. Didn't Jesus say, by this shall all men know that you're my disciples? If you have a book of the Bible memorized. Was that it? That you pack the pews. Hey, I'm all for coming to every service all the time. Believe me, I'm all for that. But what's the mark of the Christian? Love one for another. That's the mark of a Christian. That's what the world should be able to recognize and know, that you're a child of God. And yet, sadly, love, that kind of love, can be very hard to find among God's people, among godly parents. And the mom and the dad shake their head in dismay. We got him to church, we put him in the school, we paid the school bill, we kept him out of the public school, we kept him, we didn't have the TV, we didn't have that, we did everything right. We made sure to lecture him with long Bible-based lectures. Hey, I'm all for biblical instruction. We believed in the rod of correction, and believe me, we tried to drive it far from him. But he went away, turned his heels, and went off to the world. What did we do wrong? Now, there's no way for me to know. But it's possible that though everything seemed right, that child never felt the love of God and never felt the love of God through you. That could be it. And off they went to find it. You see, if we don't learn this overflow principle, we're going to hurt a lot of people. We've all been hurt by those who didn't know how to love. And we're just going to pass it on. See, let's dig in here in John chapter 4. The overflow principle starts with the source of love. Verse 7, beloved, let us love one another, for love is of what? God. So who's the source of love? God. And if you're born again, you're already plugged into that source. The source himself has moved in. You've been born of the Spirit if you're saved. And so you are already connected to the source of love. God is the source of love. Hallelujah. And so notice what it says in verse 7. And everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. Now, that's an interesting statement. Everyone that loveth is born of God and knoweth God. What this is saying is the kind of love we're talking about, the kind of love that hits the spot, happens to be the kind of love that is exclusively found in Christ. The world can't do it because they're not plugged into the source. If you find this kind of love, you've just found a Christian. Now, I understand there's some lost people that might even seem like Christian, and it's not our job to figure out their motives. My point is, Christ-like love comes from who? Christ, from God. And so if you stumble across that kind of love, you probably stumbled across a Christian born again, because this kind of love is of God. Does that make sense? So there is an exclusive, beautiful love that only we can experience. And the world can't have it unless they meet Jesus. Maybe someone in this room, you've never known this kind of love because you don't know Jesus. Tonight is the night to put your faith in Jesus and be saved. And you can know the love of God. Verse 8, he that loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Now, it's possible to be saved and not know God very well. And that's all of us are in the process of sanctification, right? Shouldn't we all want to know him better, know him more? All right, so if you find a Christian who is born again but is sorely lacking love, and that's been me before, maybe it's you right now, I've been saved but lacking in love. Why? I didn't know God very well. See, if you know God, you're going to be like God. His love will start to rub off on you. All right, so you've got to be saved, plugged into the source, and then you have to actually know him, for his love to begin to be manifested in us. Verse 9, in this was manifested the love of God. In this was manifested or revealed. In this way was the love of God revealed toward us, because God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. So how was God's love revealed to the world? One word, the cross. Amen? That's the love of God in a picture. It's the self-sacrificing, selfless, no strings attached kind of agape love that's only found in Christ, and it was displayed on the cross. So what's the reaction? Verse 11, beloved, if God so loved us, in other words, if God loved us in that way, we ought also to love one another. And the idea you see in verse 17 completes that thought. Verse 19, we love him because, say it, he first loved us. It doesn't say, guilt trip, it doesn't do this. You ought to love God because he loved you. Now, we could phrase it that way if we wanted to. You know, sometimes we're good at being professional guilt trippers. And hey, we need to feel that once in a while. It's called conviction. The Lord's allowed to step on our toes and twist the knife of conviction. But the point is not, God loved you, so you better love him. No, if that's the way you're reading it, you're missing the whole point. The point is, because God loves me, I love him. It's a natural rebound. It's a natural outflow. It's a natural overflow of the inflow. Does that make sense? When you start to realize the love that God has towards you, it causes you to rebound, reflect that love back to him. We love God because he first loved us. But here's the problem. We have not always known and believed the love of God toward us. Look at verse 16. And we have known and believed. I think all of us know that God loves us. But we don't all believe it. We're kind of like that child. Well, I know mommy loves me, but I don't think she likes me very much. I know daddy loves me, but he doesn't seem to want to be around me. I think there's something wrong with me. Now, what a heartbreak, by the way, if your child thinks that way of you. But you see, many times people think that way of God. I'm talking about saved, born again Christians. Your name's written down in glory. Amen. And you know that God loves you, but you don't always really believe that he loves you. Yeah, I know he died on the cross for me, and I'm really appreciative of that. I'm so glad that I'm saved and going to heaven. But sometimes we have this idea that, you know, I have a feeling that God's up in heaven looking at me with a perpetual frown. Like, oh, can't believe it. You're still doing that? You haven't gotten over that yet? God's up in heaven, just furrowed brow. Maybe worse than that, anger. Just, okay, buddy, you're about to get that lightning bolt. I really do believe there's a lot of Christians who, they know God loves them, but they've never really felt it. They've never really believed it. And so therefore, even though God does love them, they're not perpetually receiving that reality by faith. It's as though God does love them, it's not really overflowing from their heart. They don't feel loved. And one thing I'll tell you for sure, if you don't feel loved, you will not be a loving person. Mark it down. If you feel as though God's love has to be earned, that God is up there shaking his head and saying, all right, I love you, but, you know, I'm perpetually disapproving of you unless you get your act together, unless you measure up, unless you earn my favor, then I am opposing you, I am upset with you. By the way, that's a religious view of God. That's how the world thinks of God. An angry God that has to be appeased by obedience and ritual and all of this stuff. And see, we get saved by grace, praise the Lord. But then we slip back into a religious view of God. That somehow I have to do, and really try and really, really confess. And it's right to confess, by the way. We ought to confess our sins, amen? But some folks they're just in this religious mindset. I've got to do, I've got to confess, because, you know, God's probably not happy with me. And so they have this religious view of God. They're not overflowing with the love of God, because they don't even know what it is. So guess how they treat everybody else? You got to measure up to get my approval. That's what Dad says. Now you interview Dad. Do you love your son? Oh, I love my son. You interview the son. I don't think Dad loves me very much. I just can't please him. I can't do anything right. He's always mad. You know, he's right. You're probably always mad. Why are you always mad? Because he's such a pathetic son? No. He's a great son. I love my son. I love him. I love him with all my heart. Okay, well, why are you always mad? I don't know. I guess I probably am mad too much. I got to work on that. No. Your real problem is this. You don't know and believe the love that God has for you. you're not overflowing with the fact of God's unconditional grace of love toward you. Did you get saved by earning it? Yes or no? Mm-mm. It's called grace. And believe it or not, though our sin does grieve the Holy Spirit, I'm not minimizing that, the fact remains that God looks down upon you with love and favor because he sees you in Christ, you're washed in the blood, you're called by his name, and yes, he grieves when we stumble, but no, he's not up there perpetually frowning at you. In fact, when you confess and you come back, the Lord is cheering you on. Did you know that? God is on your side. Romans chapter 8, if God be for us, who can be against us? Your God is for you, not against you. But see, if you as a dad or a mom, if you're not receiving the love of God for you, you can't give that kind of love to anybody. That explains a lot of heartache in marriages and homes, from religious saved people, like in this room. We're not doing so good with the second and third generation, are we? Generally speaking. We got the doctrine, we got the Bible, we got the principles, we got the standard, we got a little backbone because of how we were raised, and now we got a godly conscience and a moral standard, and so now we're going to try to pack that into those little hearts. We're going to try to enforce it, and just we're going to try to make them do right, and sure, we love them, but they're probably never going to feel it unless they just happen to measure up enough. And unfortunately, the one or two kids who figure out how to measure up, they don't know the love of God either. Know what they've discovered? They've discovered how to keep an angry God happy. Some of you have good kids, but they're not godly kids. Because they don't know the love of God. But they know how to obey enough to get your praise. They know how to obey enough to get your approval. And they know how to put on a front, too. So mom and dad can say, oh, yes, oh, my son, oh, my daughter. And you feel loved. But it's not love. It's actually false love. It was earned, merited. You see the problem with this? This kind of lack of love in relationships either causes rebels who are crumpled and destroyed by rejection, or it causes self-righteous religious children who have learned to conform for the pat on the back, but neither one of them knows anything about the love of God. Why? Because mom and dad aren't living from the overflow. They themselves have the wrong view of God. And the Bible says, don't you realize? Jesus loves you. Period. Amen. What else does he have to do? He poured out his blood for you. He went to the cross. Jesus loves you. And because you know it and believe it, you can pour it out from the overflow. I like to think of this just a very simple picture. If you go hiking up in the mountains, I had a chance to do this back in my college days as we did some traveling with a music group, and we did some hiking and up a side of a mountain. And there was a beautiful mountain stream coming down. You could see it. But my favorite part was where that mountain stream hit a little cliff and then dropped and pooled and dropped. Just a beautiful cascading waterfall. And down it came. Splash, splash, just cascading over from above. You know, if God's love is flowing in, it can cascade over to your wife, to your children, to your husband. How does this work? You have to believe the love of God. I think the best way to do that is to express it by faith. You know, we talked about the Spirit-filled life. One of the ways you can access it was praise. Do you remember that? If you're here, praise can access the Spirit-filled life. Watch this. Lord, thank you that you love me unconditionally. Thank you, Lord. So then you take that truth, you let it overflow your heart. Now, Lord, help me to love my son unconditionally. Thank you, Lord, that I'm forgiven. Amen? Are you glad about that? Thank you, Lord, that you love me so much that I'm forgiven. Thank you for forgiving me. So, Lord, I'm going to take that same generous forgiveness. I'm going to share it with my son, with my daughter, with my wife, with my husband. Thank you, Lord, for lovingly putting up with my weakness. Thank you, Lord, for your patience. Anybody glad the Lord's patient? When you say thank you, you're just receiving the fact of his love. He already loves you. But when you praise him, you're receiving it in a fresh way by faith. Lord, thank you for your patience. And so now, Lord, help me to share that same patience with my coworker. Lord, I don't deserve your patience, and they don't either. But Lord, you've shared your patience with me undeservedly. I'm going to share that patience with them. You know, it's kind of like a birthday cake. Can you imagine a kid just spoiled rotten, has all the friends over. There's a big, beautiful cake. All these presents, and so everyone gathers around, they sing the song, he blows out all the candles, and then he's like, okay, pulls the cake over to himself, y'all go home. This is my birthday cake. It's ridiculous. What kind of a brat would do that? Well, it's mine, it says my name on it, you know, Johnny, this is my birthday cake. Wait, buddy, that cake is more than you need. In fact, that cake was designed to be what? Shared. Did you realize that God's love for you is abundant and free and generous, and it's more than you'll ever need? And he has poured it out, and it was designed to be shared. You say, thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. Now help me to forgive this one right here. Thank you, Lord, for your patience. Now help me to love and be patient. And so you live from the overflow. You take it by faith and you give it by faith. And that's how others are touched by the love of God. Do you understand the overflow principle? It may be that your children haven't felt loved because you've not received God's love for you. Now let's go quickly and look at this acronym here. Let me ask you a question. If you were loved, how would you know it? If you were loved, how would you know it? What would it feel like? Well, baseline, if someone loved you, it probably means they like you. Let's start there. They like you. Remember the child, I made the scenario, well, I know daddy loves me, but I don't think he likes me. You see, if you don't feel liked, you don't feel loved. Did you know that God likes you? Do you believe that? He made you in his image. He redeemed you by his blood. He has a perfect plan for you. You'll never get to the bottom of all of his thoughts for you. His thoughts are favorable and good. God actually likes you. And so some of us have a hard time with this. We really feel like God couldn't possibly like me the way I am now. He's got to see what a broken mess I am. Oh yeah, God sees the mess and he likes your mess. You're his mess. Amen? And he's got plans for your mess. He's got plans to clean up your mess. He's got plans to turn your mess into a miracle. Yeah, he likes you. Does he want the mess to stay a mess? No, he's got plans for that. If you work with him, he'll work with you. God loves you. It's called being accepted. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. Ephesians 1:6. God likes you. Let me ask you this question. Do the people in your life know that you like them? God likes you. He accepts you. Are there people in your life that you perpetually reject? Well, they're not godly enough. Like me. Well, they don't deserve approval. I'm not saying you have to approve of their sin. I'm saying you have to show generous acceptance to them where they're at in life. Can God take them from where they're at and get them where they need to be? Can he? Can God do that for you? God accepts you. And let me ask you, husbands, does your wife know that you like her? Does she know that she's your favorite person? Ladies, does your husband feel as though you like him? Many times that is not the case. There's many a man who does not even feel tolerated, much less liked, by the one who supposedly loves him. The lady says, well, you don't understand what I have to put up with. He's just a brute. He stinks. You know, he does all this stuff. He's not even godly half the time. You have no idea what I put up with. I can imagine, I mean, I am one, so I can kind of imagine my wife has to put up with an awful lot. But you know what? Do you like him? Do you accept him? Well, he's a mess. I know, but he's your mess. Amen? He's your mess. He could be somebody else's mess. He's your mess. He's yours. Do you accept him? If you feel loved, it's probably because you feel liked. If you feel loved, it's probably because you're observed. Does God observe you? Of course, he sees everything. No. God watches over you. Thou knowest my down-sitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off. Psalm 139, the whole chapter, you ought to read it. It talks about how God just hovers over us. He's intimately concerned all the way down in the womb. He's forming you detail by detail. God observes you. Now think about kids, little kids especially. When they're at the park and they're doing their thing, what do they say constantly? Dad, Dad, look. Dad, look. Look, look. Hey, Dad, look. Mom, look, look, no hands. Famous no hands, right? Crash. They make a little two-year-old drawing. Daddy, Daddy, look. I've learned to say, wow, okay? Wow, that's beautiful. Don't say, is it a tree? You'll break their heart.
It's a lion, Daddy.
Oh, it's a wonderful lion. Look, why do they want you to see their picture? Because they feel loved when you look. Why do you think, husbands, why do you think your wife wants you to look at her when you talk? Because she feels loved when you see her. The loneliest people are the people who feel invisible. They're in a crowd, nobody sees them. They're at church, nobody sees them. It's a terrible feeling. Does your wife, does your husband, do your children feel loved because you see them? You observe? You're attentive? If you feel loved, it's probably because you feel valued. Does God value you? How would you know if someone is valued? By the price you pay. The price you pay assigns a value to something. For as much as ye know that ye were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, you weren't redeemed with those things, but with the precious blood of Christ. How were you redeemed? The blood of Christ. You know, I'm not a stamp collector, but if I was, I might assign quite a lot of money to a little scrap of paper. In fact, I'm sure that there probably exists a little tiny scrap of paper as big as the little piece of straw you rip off of the straw wrapper and throw it away. A little tiny scrap of paper might be worth $100, $1,000. Any stamp collectors out there? Anybody? Do you think there might be a stamp worth $1,000,000? Now, why would that little piece of paper be worth so much? Here's why. Because someone's willing to pay it. That's the price it got at the auction. It was assigned to it. And here's the question for you. If God paid with the blood of his son for your soul, do you have value? The devil wants to say, you're dirt, you're dirt, you're worthless, you're a sinner, you call yourself a Christian. Oh, the devil wants to grind you. But the Bible says, no. You're my precious jewels. I bought you with the price of my son. I have assigned eternal, unspeakable value to you. Let me ask you this question. Does your loved one feel valued? Have you shown that by lavishing time, sacrifice, gifts, investment of yourself to show that she or he is special? Well, I'm gone all the time to earn money to keep the house and to put them through college. That's wonderful. And yes, that is love. But your loved ones might not feel loved because they never see you. There's wisdom here. We need wisdom, don't we? If you feel loved, it's probably because you feel valued. Do the people that you say you love feel valued by you? Do they? If you feel loved, it's probably because you feel entrusted. Now, this might not be as intuitive as the other ones, but think about it. When someone entrusts you with a special duty or responsibility, you feel loved by them. God has shown his love for us, not just by saving us, but by calling us and assigning us to a great task. He's entrusted us with the gospel. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, Paul says in Ephesians 4:1. The vocation, the calling. God loves you not just by saving you from hell, but he shows his love to you by calling you to be a child of God, by entrusting you with the gospel, by giving you a specific role to play in the house of God, in the work of God. Hasn't God entrusted you with some eternal things? That's a love gift to you. You know, I've learned with my boys, one of the best ways I can show love to them is to give them an important job and trust them with it. And then don't be waiting with a mallet to smack them if they mess up. No. But say, hey, you did a good job. I appreciate that. Give them something that's just hard enough that they feel it's important. And then encourage them and cheer them on and congratulate them when they do a job well done. And you'd be surprised. Just a little word of encouragement or praise and entrusting them with a task, it's like they grow a whole foot. They're just all of a sudden they're little men. Now they want to be around Dad all day. What else can I do, Dad? What else can I do? I didn't even say the words, I love you, but they felt it. They felt like they mattered. Sometimes husbands turn their wife into something less than a wife because they won't trust them with anything, and they micromanage everything, and the poor lady never actually develops or grows as a person. I've seen this. They don't feel loved when they're micromanaged. I've seen the other thing too. I've seen ladies lording over their mousy little husbands, not realizing they created a mousy little husband because they would not trust him with anything, and they spoon-fed him everything, and they corrected him about everything, and the husband somehow put up with it. And ironically, in that situation, she just learns to despise him more. When will he ever be a man? Well, maybe he'd feel loved if you entrusted him with the role God gave him. But he'll blow it. Maybe. Probably. Especially with your help, you know. But you know, that man probably will never feel loved until his wife treats him with some faith. She puts some faith in him. And let me ask you, do the people in your life feel entrusted by you? Entrusted to bear your burdens, entrusted to know your confidences, entrusted to see your vulnerabilities, entrusted to be your support, someone you can lean on, and you choose to lean on them. Finally, if you feel loved, it's because you feel desired. God desires you. So many verses, but I just picked one out of Song of Solomon. He brought me to the banqueting house. His banner over me was love. You know, God went out and sought you. I'm so glad that Jesus sought me out. Jesus sought you out. He brought you to himself. He brought you to himself because he desires a relationship with you. He really does. When you get up in the morning and you meet him, he's thrilled that you got up in the morning to meet with him. And yes, I do think it hurts his heart when we avoid and we don't spend time with him, because he desires you. Let me ask you, do the people that you say you love feel desired by you? Husbands and wives, do you desire each other's company? Do you let them know you miss them? Do you care about what's happening in their life? Are you interested? Is it clear that you're one and you can't bear to be apart? Do you make it known? Do you push things aside? Guys, do you hurry home? you don't know what I'm hurrying home to. Well, shame on you. You ought to hurry home and be a husband who pours out the love of God on your family. You hurry home and pour out the love of God on your wife, pour out the love of God on your kids, and you be receiving that love by faith. Thank you, Lord, for loving me. Thank you, Lord, for desiring me. Now let me get home and pour that out on my family, because they need it, Lord. Pour it out. In it flows, out it goes. That's the overflow. That's as simple as it gets. Well, I haven't had anything poured my direction for a while. You know, I'm not having my needs met. No. You get your needs met from God Almighty first. And then you focus on meeting their needs by the grace of God. Husbands, wives, just plug your own self into this. The overflow principle works. It's just the Spirit-filled life. You might call it revival. But all of a sudden, the love of God is what's flowing through you. Now, the last thought is this. You might say, wow, that explains it. That's why I don't feel loved. You know, nobody's loving me right. You know, the one who says they love me doesn't even like me. You know, the one who says they love me doesn't even know I exist. You know, I don't feel valued. I don't feel entrusted. I don't feel desired. And some of you might be sitting here just feeling like, yep, that's me. Listen. Let me encourage you. Nobody that you know is going to love like God perfectly. They're not. In fact, the ones who love you the most might only give you one or two of these. Maybe three, if they're a real saint. The point is this. If you're feeling unloved, rest in God's love. Be so satisfied with the fact of His love that you will gratefully receive the broken pieces of love that broken people offer you. Your wife is broken. She might only be able to give you broken pieces of sincere but insufficient love. Accept those pieces gratefully because you're satisfied in God. And then pour out His love to her. Ladies, your husband may not be able to love you the way he ought to. He may only be giving you broken pieces. But you find your satisfaction in God and then accept those broken pieces and say, you know what? I know he loves me. He's doing the best he can. And you know what? I'm going to love him with all my heart. And this kind of love starts flowing. And you just might have revival. You might save those kids. You might break a generation of cycles of hurt. And some of us need to get honest tonight and realize the ones we say we love haven't felt it from us in a really long time. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to love our loved ones, but we cannot show that kind of love unless we're overflowing with the love of God. Lord, some of us have not been receiving the love of God. We have a religious view of God. And so we have a religious view of love toward everyone else. We only show love to those who we think deserve it. Those who rub our fur the right direction. Lord, forgive us for not showing the love of Christ. Lord, help us to be sensitive to the fact that those we say we love might be hurting and might not be feeling any love because we're not really showing a Christ-like interest in their lives. We're not touching them with the love of God. We're not overflowing the love of God into their life. Forgive us, Lord. Open our eyes and change our hearts and heal our homes tonight. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. With heads bowed and eyes closed, maybe you're a Christian and you realize, you know what? I realize there's something lacking in the way I'm showing love to my loved one. God showed me there's something lacking in the way I'm expressing love. I want God to change the way I love my husband, my wife, my kids, my friend. And you're raising your hand, say, pray for me. There's something lacking in my love. Amen. Many hands. God showed me. How many of you would say, you know, I'm a Christian, I know I'm saved, but I realize my problem is I just need to start believing the love of God toward me. I want to start loving others from the overflow, but I've got to start by just believing and receiving the love of God for me, and that's what I need tonight. Would you raise your hand? Amen, amen. I want to start receiving God's love for me. Amen. Finally, this. Maybe there's someone who would say, Brother Barber, I don't know that I've ever been saved. If I died right now, I'm not sure I'd go to heaven. I'm afraid that I don't know that Jesus is my Savior. It concerns me. Would you raise your hand so I can see it and pray for you? I'm not sure I'm saved. Pray for me. Anyone? Anyone at all? Lord, you saw the hands. You know our hearts. Help us and heal us and change us by the love of Christ. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Pastor.